This past August, I had the opportunity to do some work in southern Africa. And I was working with nurses in the kingdom of Swaziland, a very tiny country between South Africa and Mozambique. Notice I said the kingdom of Swaziland. It is the only absolute monarchy left in Africa. And its ruler, King Mswati III, is an absolute ruler. There is no constitution in the country. Whatever he says is law. He's the most powerful and the richest man in the country with 23 wives. He's still the richest man in the country. And among the sights I was shown in this tiny little kingdom was a mountain that they call a mountain, I sort of call it a hill with a crag, in which King Mswati's great-grandfather would throw those who disobeyed him off the crag. He was absolute monarch. Whatever he said was law, and all who disobeyed faced death. And I tend to think that's oftentimes the power we think of when we think of king. The power to do whatever I want, the power to get others to do whatever I want with no problem for me. If they don't obey, off with their heads. And in contrast with that view, we have today's gospel. Kingship is very odd in the Gospel of Luke. In the very first chapter of the Gospel, the angel Gabriel appears to Mary and says she will be the mother of Christ, and says he will take the throne of David, his father, and of his kingdom there will be no end. That word king, referring to Christ, does not appear again in the entire gospel until right before the passage we heard. The chief priest telling Pilate, he has made himself a king, and he has put himself at odds with Caesar. Pilate asking, are you a king? The people then jeering Jesus on the cross, saying he's a king, let him save himself. And finally, what we call the good thief, asking Jesus to remember him when he comes into his kingdom. Notice, it's the very beginning of Luke's gospel, the very end, but it's always others who call Jesus king. He never uses that word of himself. And yet, as we gaze upon Jesus on the cross, we see a change in what king is supposed to be. When we look upon Jesus on the cross, we see a change in power. There are those who say, and a lot of theologians who say, that the cross shows Jesus in his powerlessness. That somehow the forces of evil seem to have won, and Jesus is there, totally passive without power. I've never agreed with that understanding. I think what Jesus has done is transform what power means. Maybe widen what power means. Power is not the power exercised by King Mswati. I'm old enough to remember Vince Lombardi. The winning is not the most important thing. Winning is the only thing. So often I think we see the only understanding of power is the power to be over someone. that the only power we understand is that if somebody bumps into me, I'm going to bump them back, just so that they know I'm there. That if someone else rises in power, I lose power. That power can only go so far, and if they have it, I don't. To me, what the cross tells us, to me, what the kingship of Jesus tells us, is that there has to be another understanding of power. Power cannot be that I'm over someone. Some power cannot mean that if they don't obey me, off with their heads. True power, I think the cross tells us, is the power to be influenced. True power, shown in the cross, is the power to stand by someone no matter what. And for me, that is what the cross is all about. God and Christ are with us no matter what. There is no place God will not go to be with us. And that is true power. The power of love between husband and wife, bearing with each other's foibles. The power of parents dealing with children, even when the children are rebellious. That is what the power of Christ tells us. And finally, I tend to think the power of Christ is most shown in mercy. That the power of God is, in fact, the mercy of God. Not only are we celebrating the feast of Christ the King today, we're celebrating the end of the holy year of mercy. And this morning in Rome, Pope Francis closed the holy door. And as he did it, he said, "We close the holy door, but we can never close the door of mercy, which is the heart of Christ open for all." We celebrate Christ the King today. We celebrate Christ the King on the cross. We celebrate not an image of powerlessness, not an image of evil winning out. What we celebrate in the kingship of Christ is a new, or maybe I should say, a very old understanding of power. The power with another. The power for another. The power that empowers another. That is the power of Christ. That is the power of mercy. That is the power of love.